To you and I welcome all of you to this talk. We have with us Professor Jean Drèze. It's a great honor for us to, as part of NUJS, to host him here. Professor Drèze does not need any introduction. His work as a development economist speaks for itself and has been a towering influence over the debates on social inequality, social justice, and human development in this country. His work has ranged from issues of rural development, social inequality, and primary education, basic healthcare, food security in particular. But his work has not only been restricted to academic contribution, but he's also been a leading figure in emphasizing on the role of social justice and social movements and public action in taking and addressing questions of public policy. He has been one of the leading lights in the movement for right to information, in the campaign towards having a national right to rural employment guarantee. He's also been a primary figure in the national campaign for right to food in India. His articulation of rights-based approach to poverty and the criticality of legal entitlements in combating deprivation is something that the role of legal entitlements in combating deprivation is something that would be of particular relevance to us among the legal fraternity. And indeed, I would not be exaggerating if I say that the contribution of Supreme Court in the PUCL, of better known as the Right to Food case, has been very sharp and incisive, largely because of the engagement with the National Campaign on Right to Food in India. And Professor Drèze has played a leading role in the feedback and the interlocutory application that were filed with the court in response to the earlier orders that were given by the court. And his role as a campaigner, his role as an academic, his role as a social activist, and also as a public policy expert, especially with the National Advisory Council, has left a deep imprint in the direction of India's policy in combating poverty and ensuring social and economic justice for a large section of our citizenry. And if you look at his in research interest, it spans across many different areas which can be clubbed together within the broad field of human development. And in this era where government policies have largely been geared towards private gain and largely been towards facilitating the role of private capital and privatization even of basic services, his interventions have been a major corrective and have played a big role in realization of some of the basic rights for our citizenry. So it's a great honor for us to have you here. And your talk today on social policy, public action, and legal rights probably would give us several points of reflection and lessons for many of us as lawyers and others who are interested in social justice and realization of the constitutional values that our preamble and our fundamental rights promise. With that, sir, I'd like to extend a very warm welcome to you and invite you over to take the floor.
Thank you very much. I think my role in some of the legislations that were mentioned tends to be grossly exaggerated. But it's true that I do believe in better legal safeguards for social economic rights, and including the rights that are mentioned in the Constitution, both the fundamental rights and other rights mentioned in the directive principles. So I'll come to that around the end of the talk. But I thought I'd begin, if you don't mind, with a few words on demonetization, because it's such a burning topic, and also because I have some piping hot data from a little survey we have just completed in Ranchi to convey the extent of the crisis that is coming. So I think it's important to be aware of what is happening and what may happen in the near future. A few weeks ago, in an interview with Economic Times, I said that blanket demonetization in a rapidly growing economy is a little bit like shooting at the tires of a racing car. And at that time, I thought it was a little bit of an exaggeration. I didn't take that metaphor literally. What I meant is that, you know, it's a bit like shooting in the direction of the tires and taking the risk that one bullet might actually end up in one of the tires and the car might wobble and slow down and so on. But actually now I think it was exactly right, the correct metaphor, that we are really shooting at the tires and bringing the car to a standstill. The Indian economy has been growing at a steady 7.5% per year, if you take some kind of 3-year average, plus or minus 1 or 2% for the last 13 years, which is a remarkable spell of high growth that I think the Indian public is not sufficiently aware of, and not something that is easy to achieve, and not something that many countries have achieved. In this quarter, post-monetization, I will not be surprised if the growth is zero, something like that. At least the growth of the private sector. The public sector, of course, will continue more or less on its normal trajectory. But a large part of the private sector is showing signs of serious recession. Every day in the paper, you must have noticed there are stories of huge declines in sales of durables, cars, mobiles, all kinds of things. Stories of farmers who have to throw away their produce because they're not able to find a remunerative price. Farmers who are postponing sowing because they don't have the cash to buy inputs like fertilizer and seeds. And also stories of people being laid off, migrant workers returning to their homes and so on and so forth. Just to look at this in a little more detail, some friends of mine went around Ranchi recently to 7 different spots in the city, like Rat Road, Main Road, Dilsachok, if you know a little bit about the geography of Ranchi. And they interviewed local traders and vendors and businessmen and also laborers. And they asked them a few simple questions, including, this was exactly 1 month after 8th of November when so-called demonetization happened. So they asked them, how do you feel your business has been doing this month compared to earlier months? So what do you feel is the decline? And most people could answer the question quite easily. And here are the results. You can see in the first column the different types of trades that we were looking at. And then in the last column, the extent of decline. So you can see for the vast majority of trades, it was a decline of at least 25% in the post-demonetization month compared to earlier month. Very often more than 50%, and in some cases even more than 75%. For example, people who sell flowers or gifts are more or less bankrupt. Obviously, if you don't have much cash, your priority is not to buy flowers or gifts. Those who tend to be doing relatively better are people like the newspaper hawkers who will just continue to sell the newspapers. In fact, perhaps people read more news now with demonetization than before. So they have not been very badly affected, similarly barbers and so on. For most trades, people report a huge shock. And it may not be easy to get out of this. I mean, it's one thing to say that we will be demonetized in a few months. Not this month, in a few months, in terms of the money supply being back. But that's not the same thing as regenerating the purchasing power. Because to regenerate purchasing power, you have to regenerate employment. To regenerate employment, you have to regenerate production. And to regenerate production, you have to regenerate purchasing power so that the producers can sell their produce. So it can be quite easy to get out of that trap once you have pushed the economy in this kind of recession. So you're looking at something potentially very serious. And the tragedy is that the hardships that are being endured by people, and especially by the poorest and most vulnerable people, casual workers, pensioners, migrant workers, who are to start with on the margin of subsistence, and then are now being subject to this massive economic shock. These hardships seem to cause very little concern in the corridors of power. They are called inconvenience. The public is facing some inconvenience, and people are asked to grin and bear it for the country's sake. In fact, worse than that, some people seem to like this disruption. In the technocratic circles today, disruption is a big buzzword, and it's a positive buzzword, that you have to disrupt things so that you can bring in a new innovation, in this case, cashless payments. Now, there may be a case for promoting cashless payments. I don't want to go into that. But I don't think the way to do it is to pull the plug on the economy. This is really not, there's no justification for promoting cashless payments that way. Now, the danger is that in that perspective, that, you know, we have to create a disruption so that some innovation can break into the new system. All these hardships become something positive. The longer the queues at the ATM, the fewer ATMs are working, the better, because, you know, we are disrupting the system, great, we are making it indispensable for people to switch to cashless payments. And I think that kind of thinking is actually quite dangerous, because it's a kind of license for causing unlimited hardship for people and even making a virtue of it. There's another big cost that is looming of this entire demonetization exercise and promotion of cashless payments, which is the mobilization of the entire government machinery for the purpose of promoting cashless payments. Today, universities, government departments, Rozgar Sevaks, Panchayat Sevaks, even Anganwadi workers are being trained and asked to go around helping people to run or to do cashless payments. Now, I don't think the role of an Anganwadi worker is to train people to make cashless transactions. I don't even understand why it's so important. It's maybe a useful convenience, I don't deny that. But why is it so important that we have to suddenly drop everything and make that the national priority and mobilize the entire machinery for this purpose at the cost of other things? You know, what are we doing in the meantime about public health, about schooling system, about nutrition, all these really important social problems, which tend to be sidelined because of this new obsession with cashless payments. So what I'd like to do now is to try to bring the focus back to some of these basic issues and the role that legal rights can play in making them more prominent in public policy and democratic politics. Let me first show you a picture. Some of you may have seen this. This is what I see in the morning in Ranchi after I wake up, not immediately, but shortly after I wake up. These are people who, while I was sleeping, have been walking 25, 30, 35 kilometers, pushing these bicycles with something like 200 kilos of smuggled coal, with very rudimentary footwear, as you can see, sometimes in the rain, sometimes in the cold, sometimes in the heat, often facing harassment from the police, to sell this coal in Ranchi and basically put food on the table at home. Not much more than that. It's basically survival activity. They, of course, must have been badly affected by demonetization, since all the trades in Ranchi are down. Surely the purchases of coal are also down, but that's not the point I want to make. The point I want to make is that when I see this in the morning, the question I ask myself is, how come they are where they are, and I am where I am? And the only answer I can find to this is luck. Some of these people may have drunk or gambled away their property, and they may be responsible in some sense for their predicament, but the vast majority of them are there simply because they were born in a poor family, probably also a low-caste family, because they were not well-nourished in their childhood. They did not have an opportunity to study or develop their skills. Perhaps their land was taken away to make space for a mine or a highway, and this is what they do to survive. And by the same logic, when we think objectively of our own privileges, we have to recognize that it has a lot to do with luck. The privileged tend to develop an impression or an illusion that we deserve our privileges, maybe because we are very bright or because we have worked hard. Well, sure, many privileged people work hard, but so do these people. They work pretty hard too. And the rest actually has very little to do with our own merits or aptitudes or health or inheritance or social connections are by and large the outcome of contingencies over which we have very little control. Even our education, if you think of it, often has more to do with the efforts of our parents and our teachers than our own merit. In other words, we live in a world where economic and social inequalities are not only very large, but also very arbitrary and very unjust. And if our fate is more a matter of chance, than personal merit, then surely the privileged have a responsibility towards those who are left behind. This brings me to the second point, that one of the great achievements, let me skip the next one, one of the great achievements of the 20th century is that many countries have put in place public services and public institutions aimed at addressing this injustice and guaranteeing the basic requirements of dignified living to everyone: food, healthcare, education, shelter, and social support in times of need. One dramatic example of that is universal healthcare, what we call universal healthcare. Now, before I come to that, let me remind you that during the 20th century, a great transformation took place in the role of the state in the economy and society. If you look at public expenditure as a percentage of GDP at the beginning of the 20th century, in the rich countries of today, for example, what are called the OECD countries, you will find that typically it was around 10%. And most of that was military expenditure, law and order, very little to do with any kind of social welfare services. By the end of the century, it was more like 40 to 50% in most of these countries, maybe a little bit less in some of them like the United States, but not much less. Furthermore, out of this 40 to 50%, standardly, something like two-thirds consists of health, education, and social security alone. So these are huge sectors, not only of the public sector, it's a huge part not only of the public sector, but also of the economy as a whole. And this has played a very important role in the improvement of the quality of life in many countries. For example, universal healthcare. The basic idea is that everyone should have access to basic healthcare, whether you are rich or poor, or for that matter, irrespective of caste, gender, ethnicity, religion, whatever it is. If you are sick, the society takes charge and ensures that you do not lack healthcare that is available. So here's a little map that shows in blue the countries in the world that have a healthcare system based on that principle. Of course, it's a principle, it's never achieved 100%. You can never ensure that everyone gets the best possible healthcare because that would be unaffordable, but you can go a pretty long way in that direction. So as you can see, many countries in the world today, this is a map I found, I suspect it comes from the CIA, because you can see the two countries in orange, Iraq and Afghanistan. And if you have a very good eyesight, you can see the caption which says, Iraq and Afghanistan, universal healthcare provided as part of war funding. But anyway, assuming the map is reasonably correct, you can see that not only most of the rich countries today have universal healthcare or something approaching it, the bulk of Western Europe, Canada, Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand, basically, all the OECD countries, with the notable exception of the United States, where a large proportion of the population is still doesn't have a health insurance and is greatly vulnerable to poor health. But also, the list includes now a growing number of developing countries, including many countries in Latin America, Brazil, Mexico, Cuba, of course, since a long time. Thailand, Vietnam, but not India. India is still very far in this field, and for that matter, in terms of developing other institutions of social solidarity. Let's look at the next one. So if you were to look at the combined population of these countries in blue, leaving out Africa, where unfortunately there's very little by way of universal healthcare so far, about half of the world population outside Africa today lives in a country with a healthcare system based on the principle of universal healthcare. And that's actually it's a revolutionary idea, historically speaking, that you know we can provide healthcare to everybody, irrespective of their social background. But a large part of the world population now lives in a country where the healthcare system is based on that principle. Let's go to the next one. India, however, has made very little progress in this field. If you look at health expenditure, or rather public expenditure on health as a proportion of GDP, it is one of the lowest in the world, it's barely 1%. It's been about 1% for at least the last 25 years, probably more than that, probably even less than 1% before that. Compared to 2.5% in sub-Saharan Africa, 2.9% in East Asia, including China, and 7.8% in the European Union. So we're absolutely at the bottom of the pile in this respect. And correspondingly, if you look at the second, the last column, which is public health expenditure as a percentage of total health expenditure, you can see that in European countries, typically, the bulk of health expenditure is public health expenditure, because basically when you call in, the society takes charge. Whether it is through something like the National Health Service in the UK, where you just walk into a public hospital and you get treatment without even having to take your wallet with you, or whether it is through some system of social insurance where you contribute, and then when you fall ill, the costs are borne by the social insurance. By contrast, in India, we have an extremely privatized healthcare system where the bulk of expenditure is private. And healthcare is a little bit like any other commodity. You go to a doctor or a chemist and you buy healthcare or drugs over the counter, which is a very bad way of organizing a healthcare system. This is something that has been well understood in economics for a long time. There are so many different kinds of market failures in health that private provision really doesn't work very well on its own. Now, it's not just about health. I'm talking of health because health is the most important aspect of the quality of life. If you're not in good health, nothing else can happen. You can't study, you can't have a social life, you can't work, everything gets held up. So health is the most critical aspect of the quality of life. And it is in that perspective that it is really shocking that we spend only 1% of the GDP on public health expenditure. It's completely abnormal. But it's also other aspects of social welfare. Next, for example, I don't have similar figures for social security expenditure for the whole world, but there are figures from the ADB for Asian countries. So if you look at expenditure on what is called social protection, which would include things like the Employment Guarantee Act, for example, in India, food subsidies, social security pensions, and so on, it adds up to 1.7% of GDP. Compared to twice as much in the lower middle income countries of Asia, which is the group to which India belongs, and much higher figures in the higher income countries, more than three times as much in China as a proportion of GDP. And of course, on top of that, the GDP is higher in China, so there's a huge gap there, and 19.2% in Japan. So you can see that here again, India is at the bottom of the pile, and it's important to say that because in the mainstream media, and especially in the business media, an impression is often created that India is a kind of bloated welfare state which has really gone too far, and there are too many so-called freebies and so on, and it's time that we start bringing that under control. Now this is actually the opposite of the facts. The fact is that India is way behind many other countries, including countries at a similar level of GDP in terms of the extent and reach of social programs. Okay, coming back to health, one aspect of public health where India has most dramatically failed, and it is actually the most important aspect of health provision, is public health, by which we mean activities such as the control of communicable diseases, sanitation, immunization, waste disposal, water supply, and so on and so forth. These are very important because they deal largely with communicable diseases where private provision really doesn't play any role. It really takes some kind of public action to deal with them. Now here India fares poorly, not only in comparison with countries like China, as is well known, or other countries of East Asia, but also compared with its neighbors in South Asia, including the much poorer neighbors, countries like Bangladesh and Nepal, which are very much poorer than India. For example, Bangladesh has about half of India's per capita GDP. And yet, as you can see from this table, Bangladesh is doing dramatically better than India in the field of public health. This data comes from two surveys which are as comparable as things get. This is the National Family Health Survey 2005-06 for India, in the Demographic and Health Survey 2007 for Bangladesh. So similar survey, similar methods, almost the same reference year. And you can see that whether you look at immunization or breastfeeding, micronutrient supplementation, treatment of diarrhea, sanitation, in all these respects, Bangladesh at that time, this is about 10 years ago, was already pretty close to universal coverage. Not quite there, but around 90% in each case. And if you were looking at the figures today, you would find that Bangladesh is even closer now to universal coverage, in sharp contrast with India, where the coverage is below 50% in each case. Now, of course, we have made some progress since then, but even today, the basic contrast would remain. And next one, and this may well be one reason why the infant mortality rate and other aspects of child health and child nutrition have improved much faster in Bangladesh than in India in the recent past, even though India was growing so much faster. I mean, India has been having a booming economy for a long time compared to Bangladesh. And yet infant mortality, as you can see from the graph, is declining faster in Bangladesh than in India. And partly because of this better record in the field of public health. This is not an isolated pattern. I mean, I'm looking at infant mortality because the data are pretty good and because the pattern is particularly clear. But you can look at many other social indicators, and again, you find that India used to be doing best in South Asia next to Sri Lanka about 25 years ago. Sri Lanka, of course, has been doing much better for a long time. And today, it tends to be second worst next to Pakistan. For example, that would apply to child mortality rates, where India has the second highest levels in South Asia next to Pakistan. India has the lowest life expectancy at birth in South Asia along with Pakistan, the second highest maternal mortality rate next to Nepal, the second highest fertility rate next to Pakistan, the worst child immunization rates along with Pakistan, the lowest rates of access to improved sanitation by a long margin among all these South Asian countries, and to the best of our knowledge, also the highest proportion of underweight and stunted children, not only in South Asia, but pretty much in the entire world. So the question arises, why is it so hard for India to do simple things like immunize all children or ensure that everyone has a latrine, when this has been achieved to a much larger extent in poorer countries of South Asia? Well, there is no simple answer to that question, but there is growing evidence that this problem is connected in various ways to the extreme and special nature of inequality in India. What I have in mind is not just the economic inequalities, which are themselves quite large, but also inequalities of gender and caste, which are also very extreme and tend to reinforce and compound other inequalities and produce one of the most stratified and divided societies in the world. The result is that those who are at the bottom of this structure of reinforcing inequalities, the Dalits, the women, and so on, are in a situation of extreme subjugation and disempowerment. They are unable to participate in democratic institutions and make their voice heard. They are unable to make good use of public services, including the education system. They are unable to protect themselves from corruption and exploitation. And of course, they also find it difficult to do well economically. Let me give you some illustrations of this connection between the slow progress of social indicators and social inequality. One field where the connections are becoming reasonably clear is that of child health and child nutrition, which has a lot to do with gender inequality. We tend not to realize that gender inequalities are really extreme in South Asia and within South Asia, in particular in India. India shares with East Asia a huge problem of boy preference and imbalance in sex ratios, for example. It shares with West Asia a big problem of very low participation of women in the workforce as remunerated workers, and it shares with Africa a big problem of low educational levels among girls and women, and it is the only region of all those that has all these problems at the same time. We are seeing a kind of confluence of different aspects of gender inequality and disempowerment of women. And there are all kinds of implications of this for health. It means that women have often very little knowledge of health matters, including childcare. They have very little power within the family. They find it difficult to use health services. Their needs and interests are not on the political agenda, and so on and so forth. And all this has all kinds of repercussions for children. Another interesting link that has come to light recently in research by Diane Coffey and her colleagues is the low weight gain in pregnancy among Indian women. Before pregnancy, Indian women are already among the most malnourished in the world with very low BMI, body mass index, which is an index of malnourishment. But on top of that, they gain very little weight in pregnancy compared to women in other countries. And the result is that at the end of her pregnancy, the average Indian woman is less heavy than the average African woman at the beginning of her pregnancy. So it's an extreme problem, which of course has very serious consequences for low birth weight, and therefore for child nutrition, not just child nutrition, but nutrition throughout one's lifetime, and of course for the intergenerational transmission of undernutrition. Another field with some interesting connections of that kind are emerging is sanitation. Now, as you probably know, India has a huge sanitation problem. If you look at the proportion of households that practice open defecation, it's still around 50% in India, which is about the highest in the world. Not quite. I mean, you can go to some countries like Chad or something, which are not only desperately poor, but also have such low population density that you might even find even higher rates of open defecation there. But barring a few other countries, it's really the highest in the world. And if you look at open defecation per square mile, which is what matters from the point of view of health hazards, India is absolutely way out and in a category of its own among all countries in the world. And you can see from this table, within South Asia also, India is doing worse. In Bangladesh today, these figures are for 2012, but apparently in Bangladesh today, 99% of households have a latrine of some sort. So open defecation has been more or less eliminated. And India was still very far from that goal. Now here again, there are connections with social inequality. One reason for the low progress in India is that the victims are largely women and also old people who tend not to have much voice within the family. So again, there's a connection here with gender inequality. And there's also a connection with the caste system, because one thing that recent research brings out is that one of the difficulties in promoting latrines in India is that people are very anxious about what is going to happen when the pit fills up and somebody has to empty it. Dalits don't want to do that anymore, quite rightly and quite understandably. Other people are also very reluctant, so what is going to happen? And therefore people either continue to defecate in the open to slow down the filling of the pit, or they insist on building a huge pit so that it will not fill up within their lifetime. And that's when the problem is left to the next generation. And this is the kind of thing that makes it difficult to promote very simple, low-cost latrine of the sort that Bangladesh, despite being much poorer than India, seems to be able to afford for everybody. So again, connections with social inequality. Literacy is another obvious example. Here again, India doesn't fare very well compared to its poorer neighbors. Here is a bar chart that shows literacy rates by age group in 2011. Now, if you start from the left, the first three bars show the literacy rate in the 10 to 19 age group in India, Bangladesh, and Nepal. And then the next set of three bars is the literacy rate in the age group of 20 to 29 in 2011, which you can also think of more or less as the literacy rate in the age group of 10 to 19 in 2001. Yeah, it's not exactly right, but it's more or less right. So if you read from left to right, you can think of this as showing the literacy rate in the younger age group of 10 to 19 in 2011 and 2001, then 1991, 1981, and 1971, and that makes it possible to look at the progress of literacy in the younger age group over time in these three countries. And you can see that the bar suggests, the chart suggests that India used to be way ahead of both in Bangladesh and Nepal in terms of literacy in the younger age groups. But then over time, these two neighbors, much poorer neighbors, have been catching up with India, and today the literacy rates in younger age groups are similar in all three countries. Again, despite India growing much faster and being much richer. So something has not really worked very well, obviously, in the schooling system. And here again, one of the things that are slowing things down, or seem to be slowing things down, is that the schooling opportunities and educational norms tend to be very compartmentalized by gender and caste. Here is an interesting table that comes from a village where I did some fieldwork in the 1980s and 1990s called Palampur. Some of you may have heard of it because it's a very widely studied village. We're looking at literacy rates by social group and for males and females. And you can see that within a small village of about 150 households, there were communities, in this case the Kayash, who have a very strong tradition of commitment to education, who managed to be fully literate, male and female. If the local school didn't work, never mind. The adult women were educated, so they would organize tuitions at home and make sure that their children would be at least able to read and write, and that was an absolutely overriding priority. And then there were other groups that had much lower literacy rates. The Dalits were still almost entirely illiterate at that time, and the Dalit women had a literacy rate of zero. So within the smaller village, the literacy rate varies from 0 to 100, depending on which group you are looking at. Now obviously in a situation like this, where the educational norms and opportunities and values are so compartmentalized by caste and gender, it's very difficult to reach the goal of universal literacy in a reasonable time. So these are just some examples of how inequality makes it difficult for social policies to succeed. One can give many other examples. For instance, inequality tends to distort the priorities of public policy. It tends to facilitate corruption, undermine cooperative action, magnify the social distance between doctors and patients, marginalize Dalit children in the classroom, stifle women's agency in the family and society, and so on and so forth. All this, of course, applies in other countries too, but it is a particularly serious issue in India, where the mutually reinforcing inequalities of class, caste, and gender are possibly more debilitating than almost anywhere else in the world. So with this background, the background of extreme social inequality, of extreme disempowerment of the underprivileged, including political marginalization, and of very limited development of the welfare state, if you want to call it the welfare state, in India, there is a case, I believe, for putting in place stronger legal safeguards for social economic rights, such as the right to food, the right to work, the right to education, even the right to health, many rights which are part of the Constitution, at least partially, but lack legal safeguard. Legal entitlements can help to address these problems of inequality and disempowerment and marginalization, at least in principle, by giving the underprivileged some bargaining power and making the state authorities accountable to them. I think that is the basic motivation and the basic idea of legal entitlements, that the state will have to pay more attention to people's basic needs and will be, at least to some extent, accountable to the people. This is not a new idea by any means. Almost all the countries that have some kind of welfare state have laws that define what people are entitled to. For example, if you look at the National Health Service in England, it was created under the Public Health Services Act, and it has a constitution, the NHS has a constitution, which spells out in detail the rights and duties of patients and service providers. Similarly, in a country like Brazil, which is a developing country,
The democratic constitution explicitly recognizes universal rights to healthcare and education, and also spells out in some detail the implications of these rights and makes these rights enforceable in court. So there's nothing new about the idea of legal safeguards for social economic rights. In India itself, it is a new idea. Not a new idea. If you look at the constitution, which I'm sure you all know much better than me, you will remember that there are two kinds of rights in the constitution. There are fundamental rights, which are enforceable in court, and then there are other rights that are part of the directive principles, which at least in the initial scheme of things were not supposed to be enforceable in court. In fact, Article 37, which precedes the directive principles, says explicitly the provisions contained in this part shall not be enforceable by any court. But the same article proceeds to say that the principles therein laid down are nevertheless fundamental to the government of the country, and it shall be the duty of the state to apply these principles in making laws. So there was very much an idea that the rights of the directive principles, which by themselves were not enforceable in court, like you can't go to court and say, I would like to work, give me a job. You can't do that. You can't invoke the directive principles for that purpose. But there was a notion that the state would frame laws that give expressions to these directive principles. For example, the National Employment Guarantee Act can be seen as an attempt to put in place a law that at least gives expression to a part of the right to work as spelled out in the directive principles. And it is in that spirit that a number of laws were enacted in the recent past, like, as I said, the National Employment Guarantee Act, the Right to Information Act, the Food Security Act, the Forest Rights Act, the Right to Education Act, and so on. Some of these laws have been more successful than others. Right to Information Act, I think, for example, has been a great success. Other laws have been less successful. You can discuss some of them during the discussion if you like. I'll just end on two general remarks about these laws, one positive and one negative. The first one is that there is more evidence than most people realize about the positive achievements of these legislations. The media tends to focus on the failures, and of course that's part of the role of the media. The media has to expose corruption when there is corruption. It has to expose lack of accountability, irregularities, and that is what you tend to read about the most. But if you look at research on whether it is employment guarantee, midday meals, social security pensions, the Right to Information Act, you also find a lot of positive findings. Nothing is perfect, but you find, for example, instance of sort of evidence of the substantial impact of the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act on rural wages, which had been stagnating very badly before the Employment Guarantee Act came into force in 2006, and then started growing not very fast, but to a significant extent after that. I'll quickly show you. Remember, you have to go two slides down. Yeah, no, that one, yeah, yeah. So you can see the growth of rural wages before 2005-06 in the last decade was pretty close to zero for men and women in rural areas. And then after the NRG came into force, it picked up a little bit. Still not very high. I mean, in an economy that grows at 7 or 7.5% per year, you would really want the wages to grow much faster than that. But at least it is something. Now, of course, this is just suggestive, but there are quite a few econometric studies of the impact of the Employment Guarantee Act on the growth of wages, and almost all of them show an impact of a similar nature. Similarly, there is evidence that programs like the ICDS, the Integrated Child Development Services, which has been greatly helped by Supreme Court orders and more recently by the National Food Security Act, have an impact on child nutrition. For example, on the height of young children, there is evidence that midday meals had a big effect on school participation, again, partly because of the Supreme Court orders and later on the National Food Security Act. There is evidence that social security pensions do a great deal for the well-being of elderly people and widows, even though the amounts are very small, and they should really be raised, but even that little means a lot to old people and to widows. there is evidence that the public distribution system, which used to be really in very bad shape, has improved a great deal in recent years, and is now making a very significant contribution to the reduction of rural poverty. So there are, of course, many shortcomings and many failures, but there are also very substantial achievements, which mean a lot for the underprivileged and poorer sections of the population. Now, so that's the good news. The bad news is that it would be hard to claim, in my view, in most cases, that these laws have achieved their objective with the partial exception of the Right to Information Act. What I have in mind is that if you ask whether these laws have put pressure on the government to act, then I think there's no question that they have. If you look at the expansion of public works after the Employment Guarantee Act came into force, it's remarkable, a huge expansion of public works. Similarly, the Supreme Court orders on ICDS have led to enormous expansion of the reach and to some extent also the quality of services under the Integrated Child Development Services. So a lot of things have moved under the impact of laws or Supreme Court orders. On the other hand, if you ask whether these laws have succeeded in making the government accountable to people, which is the ultimate objective, I think to a large extent the answer is no. Many people have received work under the Employment Guarantee Act, but the basic principle of work on demand, that you can demand work and receive it within 15 days, still has not been realized in most of the country, let alone other rights that workers have under the Act, such as payment within 15 days, basic worksite facilities, compensation if you're not paid on time, unemployment allowance if you don't receive work. All these things are still found wanting. One reason for this, I'm afraid, is that the legal system doesn't really work. And this is something that I put to you to think about, because you are the lawyers. It's not something that I can understand very clearly, but I can see the effect. It works for a minority of privileged people. Some people in this country were educated and well off enough to take even trivial matters straight to the Supreme Court. But the bulk of people stay away from the legal system. They think of it more as a source of harassment than as a possible source of protection. And it is indeed remarkable, if you think of it, that 10 years after the Employment Guarantee Act came into force, not a single worker has gone to court to say, hey, I have demanded work, I didn't get work, I want my rights to be fulfilled. Similarly, for the last 3 years, all Indian women have had a right to maternity entitlements under the National Food Security Act, which has been brazenly violated because the central government is yet to implement this provision. And yet, not a single woman has gone to court to say, look, I'm pregnant, I'm entitled to 6,000 rupees under the National Food Security Act, and I would like my rights to be safeguarded. So, the rights that we are talking about are not generally enforced primarily by the courts. Most rights are enforced through social norms and social institutions. So it's not like you have to run to the court each time when you try to get your rights enforced. But unless the court is there as a last resort that people can invoke to enforce their rights, then all the other means of accountability tend to go down. So I think there's a real void there and something that has undermined the potential impact of most of these laws. And if you ask why the Right to Information Act is the one that actually has worked best in this respect, that has actually created a very substantial degree of accountability, I don't think it's because there are penalties. People often think it's the reason is that administrators are penalized if they don't provide the information. It's true, there are penalties. But there are penalties in many of the other acts. There are penalties in the Employment Guarantee Act, there are penalties in the National Food Security Act, and so on. I think the difference is that the RTI Act also creates a parallel structure of courts, the information commissioners and so on, which basically play the role of an ad hoc court for the purpose of the RTI and have a lot of power. And that is what makes it work and creates accountability. But for the other laws, we are still very far from the initial intention that people are actually able to claim their documents from the state as a matter of right. So I leave this with you. I have something to think about and maybe also comment on, because I'm quite curious to know what is the understanding on this in the legal profession. And I shall end here. And I'll be happy to take other questions during the discussion, because I know that some of you also were keen to discuss other things. So feel free to ask any questions, or for that matter, any comments. Thank you.
Thank you so much for reinforcing the importance of the interplay between different forms of inequality and questioning this broad narrative of Indian state being excessively intrusionary. Not that it is not in some cases, but the fact that this narrative of an excessively strong state has to be questioned, and we need to emphasize more on public healthcare, public education and social security, an area where we haven't had much focus at all. My question relates to the discussion you had at the very end of your speech, primarily looking at the role of these commissions, because you spoke of the fact that information commission and the parallel judicial or quasi-judicial bodies have played a big role in better enforcement of RTI. But when we look at the fact that even Food Security Act is supposed to have state commissions and district level authorities, and even NREGA is supposed to have revised redressal mechanisms, which haven't really been brought into effect with any degree of success in either of these two legislation, then is it so much the statutory provision for having parallel quasi-judicial bodies, or is it that the right to information had a much greater currency among middle classes and the upper middle classes, and the fact that Food Security Act or the NREGA have faced tremendous hostility from media and from influential middle classes, which has shaped the way in which state and political response to NREGA has panned out, and in contrast, RTI has been tremendously or relatively a lot more successful. Thank you.
Yeah, I think you have a point. I mean, there's no doubt that RTI is supported by the middle classes, as you said, and also for that matter by the corporate sector, because it basically reinforces the power of the corporate sector vis-à-vis the state. I do think that has made things easier for RTI, certainly. But I still think there's also a contrast in the nature of the grievance redressal structures. In the Employment Guarantee Act, there are grievance redressal provisions, which I've mentioned, like an employment allowance and compensation, and the intention was indeed that this would create accountability. But the problem is that the implementation of these provisions is still largely at the discretion of the government itself, and that's where there's something that doesn't work. Food Security Act is a bit like that also, not quite. It's true that there are state commissions under the Food Security Act, which could help if they were taken seriously. But again, the initiative to create them and so on is largely at the discretion of the state. And I think in the RTI, they are much stronger. These structures are more powerful. And of course, they also have a simpler job, because if you refuse to provide information, it's a fairly transparent irregularity. So I think the RTI is also a simpler right, and the violations of it therefore are also simpler to identify. Whereas when it comes to food security and employment and so on and so forth, these are actually comparatively very complex programs, and the irregularities themselves can be very complex, and the responsibilities can be very difficult to pin down. In the case of RTI, you ask a particular authority and then that authority becomes responsible. NIGA, there's so many different agents involved in the implementation. So if you are not provided with work, for example, you know, all kinds of people could be responsible. It could be that the money hasn't come from New Delhi. It could be that the sarpanch is not doing his job. It could be the BDO. So it becomes very much more difficult.
I have a couple of questions with respect to the service which you. Yeah. With respect to the surveys which you had immediately started with regarding the demonetization part, and the survey in Ranchi particularly.
Yes.
So therein you had shown that there are certain sectors which have actually not shown any decline at all insofar as their business is concerned. And some of them are actually cash heavy sectors. So have you arrived at any reason or any conclusion regarding why that is? And if so, how exactly these 84 businesses I think you had selected for the entire thing. So among these businesses, what was the nature of the percentage of the businesses which accept digital payment all by themselves even before demonetization? I mean, was there any correlation regarding that?
Okay, well, these are good questions, but I don't think we can answer them based on this very informal survey. This is a very preliminary survey. I mean, it's meant to bring out something that we've been suspecting, reading the newspapers and talking informally to people. So we wanted to have a kind of clearer idea. Is it just some traders and vendors, or is it across the board, and what is the extent of the damage? I don't know if I mentioned that if you take a straight average of the reported declines in activity, it's almost 50%. Okay, now this is just Ranchi, it's informal, and I don't think you can easily come to any conclusion when you compare the different types of trades, because it's a very, you know, it's a very tiny sample. So for each trade, there are just one or two or three observations. So I don't think we can do too much with this data, and I don't want to push it at all. But I do think it gives a pretty scary idea of what may be happening, and it's not just Ranchi. I mean, it's pretty consistent with what we are reading coming from other places. So I think it's a kind of warning signal. I don't think it's more than that, and I really wouldn't want to come to any more detailed conclusion based on this data. But one could do it. One could do this on, you know, larger and more bigger scale than to investigate the question that you raised.
Just apropos of that particular thing, given the fact that I'm curious to figure out that these businesses wherein the survey was conducted, so the questions were mostly put regarding how have their businesses suffered post demonetization and all.
Yes.
Has any question been posed towards them as to, despite that, whether they're favoring demonetization or not? Because, I mean, I have seen several other data from different other cities which have shown that people have actually suffered, but they still think it's a good thing because they think that there is some sort of correlation between hardship and the feeling that what they're doing is actually good for the country.
Yeah. Okay, I think you have a point. But before that, let me mention also that one thing we did ask these traders and businessmen is what happened to the personnel that they were hiring. And many of them said that we have laid off workers, or we didn't hire workers, though we would normally do this at this time of the year. So that's another really alarming indication that there are also important effects on employment. Now, coming to your question, this was not part of the survey. It could have been, maybe it should have been. If we had put that, included that in the survey, I think it's probably true, at least in Ranchi, that a lot of people would have said, okay, it's you know, it's tough, but we still support. It's quite interesting, actually, that, you know, people are hit so badly and still they are trying to support. I think there could be a couple of reasons for that. I think one is that people are quite scared of saying that they oppose because they think that this will make them look like they are party to corruption. That's one. And the other thing is that I think people have really been strongly influenced by this whole discourse on corruption, which I'm afraid is really very misleading. I mean, I didn't want to go into that because short of time, but this idea that demonetization can flush out the black economy, which is the rhetoric that is being employed, that, you know, we're going to get rid of the black economy once and for all, is totally wrong. I mean, any number of economists have tried to explain that from right from Prabhat Patanayak at the beginning to Montek Singh Ahluwalia, Amartya Sen, Pranab Sen, Krugman, you know, almost everybody. I mean, this is a rare case where almost all economists, with a few interesting exceptions, are on the same page. And the reason is very simple, that, you know, what is meant by black economy in economics is basically illegal income earning, okay? So if you evade your taxes, it's black income. If you sell charas or ganja, it's illegal income. Engage in crime, it's illegal income. Now, once you've earned that money, obviously you don't keep it under a mattress. You might sometimes keep some of it under a mattress, but mostly you use it for, you know, you invest in property, you marry your daughter or son, or you go and shop in Dubai, you launder your money, all kinds of things. And to go after the residuals, and that too in a kind of one-off way, and then claim that you're flushing out the black economy, it makes absolutely no sense. But I think that the rhetoric has captured a lot of people's imagination. I think over time it might change. My sense, based on whatever little informal interaction I have with people, is that some people are beginning to get tired and to question, you know, was it really worth it? So So it will be interesting to see the way things go.
So my question was with regards to the interrelationship between the efficacy of laws and public health that you mentioned. One of the things that you talked about was the fact that the number of people coming up to courts to enforce their rights is very low, sometimes zero.
Almost zero.
So do you think, I'm thinking along the lines of the polio eradication campaign, which went on for more than a decade here and finally managed to have some success. I'm thinking that, don't you think that there's a possibility that by creating greater awareness of the rights, because there are large sections of our population quite surely who are not even aware of the fact that these are rights which are enforceable in courts. So don't you think a governmental campaign of some sort could help ensure that, you know, better protection of these rights?
I think it would help, but the fact would remain that how is a worker in Palamo supposed to go to court and enforce their rights? I mean, it's just inaccessible, expensive, difficult to understand. I mean, there are few cases of PILs, that does happen, and that's, so it's not like nothing is happening. But for people themselves to go to court would be very difficult, even if they knew that it's their right.
Yeah, so that brings me to my next question, which is, in that situation, what would you recommend should be the structure? If it's a parallel court structure, then we have multifarious parallel court structures for each and every social welfare legislation
I don't think that would be necessarily a good thing, but I would like to think as a way of making the legal system itself more effective. I mean, this is something that you should be thinking about. And also to provide legal aid for people. I just cannot understand how you can pretend that there's any kind of equity in the legal system, which is supposed to be something, at least in court people are supposed to be equal, but actually the courts reproduce all the social inequalities and people have no recourse, hardly any form of legal aid is available to poor people. I think that's a huge lacuna, aside from the fact that the courts are clogged and so on and so forth, that they're often hostile to poor people. But I think there are a lot of things that could be done to try to make justice a little more accessible to people.
Sir, I have basically two questions. One of them is a question, and the second is a question comma comment.
Okay,
I think I'm audible. The statistics that you showed about open defecation or, the gender divide and all of these, the years of those surveys were like 2012, 2011,
yes.
And so on.
Right.
Now, did you witness a significant change, or any change for that matter, post 2014, post Swachh Bharat, post Beti Bachao Beti Padhao, and all of that? Do you have some data to suggest that there has actually been some change, or there has been absolutely no change? It's completely media, hoodwinking us.
Okay.
This is one. And the second is more in lines of the comment on RTI vis-a-vis the NREGA that Saurabh also pointed out. Don't you think that one of the reasons for the success of the RTI was that the target group for the RTI Act was everyone, as opposed to the NREGA and the Food Security Act, where the target group was only a section of the society who, as you have rightly mentioned, have very little awareness of their legal entitlements and their legal rights?
Okay, I think that's a fair point. Post 2014, I'm afraid we have very little data because, India's statistical system and particularly social statistics is in terrible shape. I mean, it's really a shame that we still have to use data from 2005-06. Now the fourth National Family Survey is beginning to come out, but it still hasn't come out. Yeah. Meanwhile, Bangladesh, Nepal, even Pakistan are doing regular National Family Health Surveys and other surveys and so on, and much more up-to-date social statistics. So I can't say much about what happened in 2014. My guess from moving around would be that, specifically with reference to Swachh Bharat and sanitation, I think things have probably picked up significantly, but that we are still way, very long distance from the goal. I mean, this idea that by 2019, we are going to achieve open defecation, I mean, that absolutely makes no sense at all. But there may have been some picking up, and that's not a bad thing. What we do see, however, forget 2014, but what is worth noting is that if you look at 2005-06 until now, with the data that we have, which is incomplete, we do see fairly significant signs of an acceleration in many social indicators. So this gap that I'm describing between India and Bangladesh quite likely has actually narrowed now a little bit in the last 10 years, partly because more has been done, because, you know, finally we have started taking some initiatives in education, and, you know, the National Rural Health Mission also, and then incentives for maternal care at the time of birth, and vaccination, and so on and so forth. And typically, in these fields, when you do something, you see some results. I mean, this is not just in India, it's across the world. So what you can see actually is fairly clear evidence that in the fields, in the limited fields, where actually there has been some action, in some cases through Supreme Court orders or legal action, or sometimes public policy, you do see things moving. And that's very important to recognize. This is why I made that point, that, you know, things, a lot of things actually are moving. And that's why I think it's a big mistake at the end of that to claim that all this was, you know, wrong, and that we have to get back to growth being the overriding objective. Not to speak of the fact that we are undermining growth now through demonetization, that's another matter. But I think on the contrary, we should see that we've actually, you know, if you look at the trends, it was quite a significant acceleration of the progress of many social indicators in the last 10 to 15 years. And we should try to consolidate that and to go further in that direction and not think that it was a mistake.
So I have two questions. First, since we're talking about this being successful in UK, notwithstanding the current criticism and the debate that's going on in UK vis-a-vis NHS and the financial constraints and all that they're discussing, why has it been a case that in India, we never thought, from a governmental perspective, since you were part of the policy making, you know, process in our country, why did we ever thought of, you know, having something in place? I mean, we have been independent since when? Did anyone think about having an NHS in India or something on those lines? That's question number one. Question number two is, there is this off comparison that we draw with China on the socio-economic parameters. Isn't the kind of system China follows, the political, the legal system that China follows, do you think it's a fair comparison, considering that we are a democratic setup and we have our own constraints and we not necessarily are governed by the privileges that Chinese administration might be governed with? So these are my two questions. Thank you, sir.
Okay. On the NHS, let me first say that the basic success of the NHS, I think, is pretty well established. I mean, if you look at the health outcomes in England and what is being spent, and you compare with other countries, especially, of course, the United States, but even other countries, it's a pretty effective system. I mean, it's very comparatively inexpensive, and the health outcomes are pretty good, and, of course, it's also very equitable. Of course, it's true that in the recent past, there have been some setbacks and new thinking and so on and so forth, but I think the basic effectiveness of the model is not in doubt. It's not the only model, of course. I mean, NHS is one way of providing universal healthcare. There are other ways, for example, social insurance. In Canada, there's no national health service, so there's a compulsory social insurance system. Everyone has to enroll, and then when you are sick, you can go to a private hospital or public hospital, but in any case, it's the state that pays. Yeah, and then there are intermediate models and so on. But the basic models are direct public provision like NHS or some form of social insurance system. So India would need to, if there were a serious discussion about this, which is only beginning to happen, we would have to look not only at NHS, but also at other options. There are some states in India that have made substantial progress. It's not true that there has been no talk of this. In fact, if you go back to the committee of 1940-something, 47, 48, they were already advocating something like a national health service. But of course, at a time when India was desperately poor and there's very little you could have provided. You could have provided still some basic public health services and so on, but nothing like a proper national health service. But now things are changing. Now, one of the consequences of rapid economic growth is that government revenue is growing really fast now. I mean, we have about four times as much government revenue, maybe five times, as 25 years ago. And if the economy continues to grow in the next 20 years like it has done in the last 20 years, we could have four or five times more 20 years from now. And that would make a lot of things possible that are not possible today. Meanwhile, some states have made progress, like Tamil Nadu, Kerala, have something already that resembles a bit of a national health service, not you know, magnificent, but quite a lot of basic services are available for to people for free and working pretty well. So it's not true that nothing has been done. But when you remember the importance, the fundamental importance of health for well-being and for development, obviously we can do a lot more.
Sir, in relation to this point you just raised, if you consider this state-wise, a lot of states have been doing really well. As you just pointed out, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, South Indian state, in general also. And a lot of other states have also been doing good, I mean, under better government. So would you lay the blame on the federal government's incapabilities, or would you say that it is the states who are not doing enough so that the country as a whole cannot rise up?
I think on the whole, in the field of social policy, the action is more at the state than at the center, and rightly so. I think it's a good thing that the states take the bulk of the responsibility for social policy. So I think the failures, like in what used to be called Bimaru state and so on, have more to do with local factors and local politics and local social structure also than with the center. The center can help. And in the last 10, 15 years, it has helped in some important ways, for example, by supporting universal elementary education cost only with some important results. So I think that whatever the center does to support is useful and important, but ultimately, the main responsibility has to be with the states. I forgot to respond on China. No, China is a very different political system, obviously. But that's not necessarily what has enabled it to progress, and it has in fact also had some very tragic consequences, like a huge famine in the late 1950s, and the Cultural Revolution, one-child policy, and so on and so forth. So when we look at China, when we are seeing that China is doing well, we should obviously not jump to the conclusion that what we need is a one-party system. I think that's the wrong conclusion. If you believe in one-party system, then you should not only look at China, but also at other countries with authoritarian governance, including Pakistan, North Korea, and so on and so forth. And then you'll probably see that we wouldn't gain much by switching to that form of political system. But you have to see the things that China has done constructively, including an early investment in education, health, and especially public health, and then try to learn from that.
I'm slightly curious about a conclusion that you drew from the slide which you had shown on the female growth of female literacy rate. I think you had compared the Indian situation with that of Bangladesh and Nepal.
Yes.
Now, extending your assumption that if you are considering the 60 to 70 thing as the what the state was the 60, 70 years back, I would say in the last 50 years we had gone from 30% to approximately 80-85%.
Sure. Huge progress,
So based on that, I think your conclusion was that there is obviously something wrong with the way we are going in. I mean, if you proceed that another 10-20 years, it's 100%. So,
if you compare India today with what it was at the time of independence, there's no doubt that there's been huge transformation. You know, life expectancy has more than doubled. Literacy was about 18% at that time. Now we are getting closer to universal literacy. Poverty has gone down, nutrition has improved. In historical terms, this is an extraordinary progress, and not confined to India. I mean, if you look at the world, if you think of what the world was like 100 years ago, you know, when Europe was in the trenches, and India and China were still going through famines regularly, when the worldwide flu epidemic was just about to come, you know, all the horrors of those times, you know, in the 20th century, there has been very significant economic and social progress. So if you look in historical terms, India has not done badly. But if you look in comparative terms, compared to what we could have done, looking at other countries around us, there's some huge, huge deficiencies.
Won't that factor be skewed by the huge contrast in terms of population between our neighboring countries and us? I mean, if you consider Bangladesh and Nepal,
larger population.
I was talking about the female literacy part, of course, wherein you had showed Bangladesh and Nepal.
You can compare Bihar and Nepal if you like. I mean, if you compare Bihar and Bangladesh, my God, I mean, you know, Bihar will look pretty bad. I have a PhD student who is doing some comparative work on Bihar and Bangladesh, and she was asking me how to select districts for a household survey. So I said, look, take some basic indicators like, you know, electrification and female literacy and so on, and then try to look for districts that look more or less comparable. And she couldn't do it because Bangladesh was just way ahead across the board compared to Bihar. Anyway, so I don't think the size of the population is what can rationalize what has happened in India.
Thank you.
related to something that was asked earlier about changes since 2014 on either toilets or female literacy, etc. And I was just wondering if you also want to comment on what's happening in the past two or three years to the data that the government is putting out. So, you know, in the first year in October, they announced that they would do toilets in all schools, and 1 year later they said we've achieved that target, but then of course when it was investigated it turned out to be false. The same thing happened with electricity, with LPG savings estimates. We've seen that again the government is fudging numbers, and what does this mean for any sort of planning or evaluation?
I'm trying to keep my mouth shut on the NDA comment, because I mean, this, what I have to say to interpret it as a political thing. But yes, I mean, there are a lot of issues.
But some
you
of
mentioned.
These problems are older also, like this LPG savings is not a specific to this government.
I mean, the failure of the statistical system goes back further, in particular of the social statistics. I do think that in the last 2 years, there has been a kind of abdication of responsibility on the part of the central government as far as social policy is concerned. I think the attitude is that let the states take care of it, and it's not really our problem. It also went together with 2 years ago some very significant budget cuts, which were justified on the grounds that the states were getting a larger share of the pool of indivisible taxes, which is to some extent a correct argument. I think over the long term it's not a bad thing that the state governments are getting a higher share of taxes and taking more responsibility for social policy. But the manner in which it was done without warning and creating a lot of confusion, I think, was not particularly helpful. But apart from that, I think there's there's at the very least a lack of clarity on social policy. What are we trying to do and how, and at worst, a kind of hostility to social policy. For example, 3 years failure to implement maternity entitlements under the National Food Security Act. I mean, this is a legal entitlement. I don't understand how the central government can get away with ignoring it completely. One example. Another example is that in the first year there was an attempt to roll back the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act to a significant extent, in particular by targeting it to selected districts. That didn't work, so there was a bit of a reversal in that respect later on. And then there was also a very unfortunate abdication as far as social security pensions are concerned. Social security pensions cost very little money, 0.1% of GDP, but they are very important for some of the poorest and most vulnerable people in society, in particular the elderly and widows and the disabled. And these programs work pretty well. I mean, there are quite a few studies now showing that there is relatively little corruption in these programs, the administrative costs are very low, and these pensions, small as they are, mean a lot to the recipients. So there was a very strong case for expanding the social security pensions. In spite of that, the central government has kept its contribution to social security pensions at 200 rupees a month now for more than 10 years, or in fact more than 12 years by now. 200 rupees a month. I mean, you can imagine how the purchasing power of 200 rupees a month has declined in the meantime. And now worse, the central government is basically losing interest in that and promoting a new scheme called Atal Pension Yojana, which is a very different thing. That's a kind of, it's a contributory pension scheme where you have to contribute for 20 years before you are entitled to anything. And if you look at the modalities of the scheme, it wouldn't be very attractive to anyone, and especially to destitute people. So, and of course it's great for the government, because for 20 years, you don't have to spend anything. For 20 years on the country, you accumulate the contributions, and then after that you have some liabilities. So it's great for the government, but not for these millions of people who depend on pensions for their survival. About 30 million people get social security pensions in India. Fortunately, the state governments often top up the central contribution. Compared with only 2.5 million people who have subscribed so far to the Atal Pension Yojana.
So, one of the critiques for implementation of socio-economic rights support has been that, you know, there is a lack of resources and it requires that. So, do you think that that is a fair argument, or do you think we're just mismanaging our resources and, you know, we have enough resources to do that? One. second, sir, there's been a shrinking space in papers for writings on agrarian reforms and rural issues, and that's why that could be one of the reasons why a lot of us are not perhaps as well, you know, educated on those. So do you think, and that ties up to how our media is owned, do you think unless other channels come up where we are, where that can, that there are bigger and stronger unbiased channels that can tell us about what really is going on, there would be any real change that can be driven? So
can you summarize the last question again?
So there's been the space in the papers and newspapers has been shrinking generally for writings on agrarian reforms and rural issues. That could be the reason why most of us, our generation, is not really up to date with what's happening, or perhaps we're not as sympathetic with what's really going on at grassroots. So do you think we need better, and that ties up to how our media is really owned. So media ownership is to perhaps blame for that. Do you think unless we have bigger, stronger, unbiased channels of journalism and media, things could really change?
Okay, now you have to remind me of the first question.
First question is resources. The critique for implementation of socio-economic rights has been lack of resources,
okay,
traditionally. Do you think that's a fair argument, or do you think we are just mismanaging our resources?
No, I don't think that lack of resources can justify some of the failures that have happened. I mean, it's lack of resources, of course, it makes things difficult. I don't think that can justify in particular the failures in public health, or even for that matter in schooling. I mean, there are so many things about the schooling system that could have been and could be improved without necessarily having more resources. But of course, resources are a constraint, and it's, as I said, one of the opportunities that we have today is that the government revenue is increasing quite rapidly, and so it expands what can be done. And of course, also we have to try to make better use of the resources that we have, and in particular try to avoid leakages, for example, which in schemes like the public distribution system used to be enormous. I mean, if you look at states like Bihar and Jharkhand, even West Bengal for that matter, 10 years ago the leakages were probably something like 80% or 90% in the PDS. Now a lot of things have improved in that respect, and we've learned a lot about how to prevent corruption and leakages. And so that's also an important part of ensuring that we're able to do well with the resources that we have. About the media, I'm not sure that ownership is the problem. I think the problem is that media is basically an advertisement business, and that's the difficulty. Well, somebody's laughing, but I think it's a fact. Media people will tell you very clearly. I mean, they are very frank about it. We are basically advertisement businesses. One consequence of that is that the readers who matter are the ones who have money to spend on the things being advertised. So the target public is largely the consuming class, and that's why there's not much focus on issues of whatever rural unemployment and poverty, nutrition, and so on and so forth, because that's not of much interest to the middle class. Of course, now we also have a lot of social media, where quite often, if you make the effort, you can get a lot of useful information on almost any topic you like. So I think we have the possibility of educating ourselves on these topics, but it's certainly true that there is still a big bias in the media as a whole, and that gets reflected in what people know and in the content of public debates.
So my question is basically, since most of us here are law students, what do you think the role of lawyers is in this whole thing, other than obvious things like social action litigation and maybe to an extent drafting legislation? Do you think that lawyers have any particular role to play in, in your experiences, what are the positive roles that lawyers can play?
Well, I think there are a lot of things that lawyers can do. I think lawyers are uniquely placed, actually, to put their skills to good use and to try to change some of these things, because there's a dearth of, I mean, again, lawyers are largely people who make business, unfortunately. Some of them do very well for themselves, but if you are motivated to put your skills and training to social purpose, there's a lot you can do. I mean, especially in the poorer parts of the country, there's a great need for example, human rights lawyers, public interest litigation lawyers, or just honest lawyers, or lawyers who are, no, I'm serious. or lawyers who are willing to work for people who don't have much money without taking big fees from them. So you know, your work is cut out if you have the motivation, plenty to do.
In the interest of time, can we wrap it up with Saurabh's question, please? And yes, that's okay with you, or would you like to take more questions?
Whatever.
Students get precedence over teachers.
Students get
precedence
over teachers.
You take this question.
Sir, especially in terms of literacy rate, the way we judge our literacy is by manner in which you can identify your name, you can write, and you can sign. That's the parameter we use to judge the literacy rate. And if we say that Kerala has 95% of literacy, do you think it's the right parameter, or do we need a more incisive test to judge our social welfare schemes, and especially in terms of literacy and other measures that we have in India? Do you think these are the right measures or the right tests that we use to judge the things that we have in India, especially in terms of literacy?
I think literacy generally is reasonably well defined. I mean, you can usually tell whether a person is literate or not, although of course there are great cases of people, for example, maybe able to sign their name but not read a text. I don't think it's true that just signing your name is adequate now for being counted as literate in the census. I think you're supposed to be able to read a simple text. To what extent it's actually done that way, I don't know. But I'm not very sure that these definition issues create important statistical biases as far as literacy is concerned. But of course, education is much more than literacy. And it's true that we should try to develop a much better information base for education and the quality of education. Now we have some data on what are called pupil achievements, for example, from ASER and PISA and so on and so forth. But not necessarily, I think that takes us one step further than literacy. But quality of education is not just read, write, and arithmetic and so on. So ideally, we should also richer information on what children learn at school and the comprehension that they have and so on. But an attempt is being made now with the CCE, the Comprehensive and Continuous Evaluation. I'm not very sure how it's actually working on the ground, but I think that was part of the intention. So yes, I think we have to try to develop richer indicators of educational achievements. But literacy, I think, generally is reasonably well defined. One more question? Yeah? Did you say something? No. Okay, two more? Why not? If you have time, I have time. How about a critical comment? How about anyone who's really angry and wants to say, what is this rubbish?
That's a comment.
You're angry?
I think that I recognize myself as a teacher who runs a seminar course which deals with rights-based approach. A lot of the questions that came up regarding the lack of application or litigation relating to NREG or for the matter of Food Security Act, doesn't that throw some fundamental questions about limitations of looking at legal entitlements? Because for people, or the class of people for whom legal entitlements matter the most, do not have functional access to judiciary.
Sure.
And in political societies where you have functional access to litigation or court, probably the public policy in any way would not necessitate creating legal entitlements in any case. So aren't we in a situation where legal entitlements become mere cosmetic especially when we see the 2 years of, or 2.5 years of the current regime, where even though Food Security Act stands on statute book, NREG stands on statute book, yet they have done a lot to emasculate each of these statutes without ever negating the formal legal entitlement. So that's one concern that has troubled myself. Mm-hmm. I want to have your views on that. The other relates to something that has occupied a lot of attention in India right now, pertaining to this UID Aadhaar project. Many of us are claiming at one hand that state needs to expand social security and other public welfare schemes. And if we are not going for universalization but go for some form of targeted delivery system, then perhaps some form of identification would be necessary. And yet at the same time, we are troubled by the way Aadhaar project has been implemented, the way it's been designed, and this privacy issue that come up with a centralized database in any case. So how exactly do we compete between this need to have some form of identification that will allow us to target in a more effective manner and minimize the cost of targeting, and at the same time also have a system which does not run into the sort of deadlock that Aadhaar has run into. So how do we really arrive at the right balance? Can we avoid having a centralized database, or is it something that is a necessary evil for us?
Okay. So briefly, I think what you said initially about the shortcomings of legal entitlements and so on, I think perhaps that was going a little too far. I mean, I do think we get something from these laws, almost all of them. But of course, we should not rely on them alone. And, you know, there are limitations, obviously. For example, in the field of education, we have made big progress in the wage and quality of schooling facilities, and I think it was a very important step, and also in bringing children into the schooling system, partly because of the Higher Education Act. On the other hand, the quality of education, which ultimately is even more important, is not something that you can easily legislate. I mean, you cannot, how do you give a child a right to quality education? It's not very clear. And the Right to Education Act, there's virtually nothing that pertains to the quality of education. So there are limitations, obviously, and there are others that I'm quite concerned about. For example, I think that many of these laws have created an unhealthy tendency towards centralization. For example, the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act initially was meant to be an enabling legislation that would create a national framework for employment guarantee, but then every state would have its own employment guarantee scheme and had its own guidelines and quite a lot of freedom within that framework. But now it's becoming more and more and more and more centralized, and it's literally now being driven by people sitting in Delhi at computers and framing an ever larger number of rules and bringing all kinds of new complications, changing the technology, and the states are just expected to adjust. I don't think that's a healthy trend, and I think that has played an important role in the decline of NIG in the last few years. Similarly with the Food Security Act. Food Security Act has done a lot of good in speeding up PDS reforms in large parts of the country, increasing the coverage, reducing corruption, and so on and so forth. But again, we are seeing now a trend towards centralization. For example, with the central government trying to impose biometric authentication in the PDS across the country, and that relates to the last question you posed about UID. Now, I think biometric authentication using UID is a disaster for the PDS, and we have a lot of evidence now from Rajasthan, from Jharkhand, from Gujarat, to some extent even from Andhra Pradesh, that this is really not an appropriate technology because, you know, it's internet-based, it's biometrics-based, it requires all kinds of sophisticated technologies to work at the same time, you know, internet, mobile, biometrics, everything, all that has to work, plus your data has to have been entered correctly in the system, then you can get your 5 kilos of grain if all this works together. And obviously, the result is that very often it doesn't work, and so it creates a lot of exclusion for large numbers of people. So coming to the last question you posed, what do we do then? I think that basically there are simpler technologies that you can use and simpler identification systems. I mean, people in India have a variety of identity cards and so on. And the thing is, you should not aim at perfection. Perfection can be very counterproductive here. UID is a system that aims at the kind of perfection that it will be completely foolproof. But actually, it ends up creating, at least in this context, a bit of a mess. So you can use other identification systems like local lists that are prepared by local functionaries, like Madhya Pradesh is doing, for instance, that may not be 100% foolproof, but at least they work, and at least they serve the purpose. And over time, you can try to improve these approaches, but at least they are based on technologies that are appropriate and that don't destroy the system. Yeah, last question.
Sir, you said that, everybody asserts it that India has developed as a whole, like all the states at similar rates after independence. Now, you talked about India and her neighbors, and you said that countries like Nepal and Bangladesh, they have matched up, and in certain parameters, they are performing better than India.
Right.
So, if we make a similar distinction between the states in India, applying the concept of competitive federalism, what effect will it have? Will the poor states, just like Nepal and Bangladesh, they are going to match up with the richer states, or are the poor states going to become poorer and the rich states will become more rich?
What do you mean by competitive federalism? I think cooperative federalism is the buzzword, but you have a new concept now that I'm curious about.
This is the Prime Minister's coinage.
He talks about cooperative federalism, by which he means you do what I say. Anyway, there are, okay, let me try to answer something about your question at least. I have not talked at all about the diversities within India, which are of course considerable and huge variation. In fact, among the inequalities that we need to take into account when we talk about India, it's not just gender, caste, economic inequalities, it's also a lot of regional inequalities. And in fact, when we look at these country averages, like Nepal versus India or Bangladesh versus India, we overlook the fact that within India there's a huge variation, much more so than in, let's say, Bangladesh. If you look across the provinces of Bangladesh, they are bunched pretty close, they tend to be bunched pretty close to the national average. One reason is that Bangladesh is less heterogeneous and agro-climatically and socially and so on and so forth, whereas India has enormous agro-climatic and social variation, and also a federal system where there are different state governments doing different things and so on. So the variation in India is much larger, with the effect that the states in India that are doing less well, like those that used to be called the Bimaru states, for example, would be even further away from what Bangladesh or Nepal has achieved than the other states. And on the other hand, it also means that some states are in India are doing much better than Bangladesh. And if you look at Kerala or even Tamil Nadu, they are even more, I mean, Bangladesh is not a model, but if it's a model at all, in some respects, Kerala or Tamil Nadu or Himachal Pradesh would be even more so. So I think we have to try to learn from this whole rich pool of experience, whether it is international, within South Asia, the contrast between India and China, the historical experience of the rich countries also for that matter, and also the diversities within India and what the better performing states in India have achieved. Yeah? And competitive federalism, we shall try to understand next time. Thank you.
On behalf of the Society of International Law and Policy and the Weekend Lecture Series, we're really thankful and grateful that you could make it to this lecture, sir. I think it's been an absolutely enriching and wonderful experience, and I'm pretty sure people with multiple questions have gained insight into what they were looking for, and on the whole, in terms of knowing more about social indicators and the interface between law and social indicators and health, I think you've really opened our eyes, sir, and to that we're really thankful. I would also like to thank all the external guests who have come for this lecture and who have made it possible. Thank you so much. I would also like to thank students and the faculty from NUJS, and lastly, all the members from both the Weekend Lecture Series and the Society of International Law and Policy, without which this lecture would have been truly impossible to organize. Thank you very much. On behalf of the Society of International Law and Policy and the Weekend Lecture Series, I request Ranchi to present her with a memento as a token of our appreciation.